Tonight I can see a star shine, and its splendor fills up the sky. It's the same that appeared and the wise men revered when hope was born this night. Out upon the snowy fields, there's a silent peace that heals, and it echoes the grace of our Savior's embrace, because hope was born this night. Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Let all of the world sing a chorus of joy, because hope was born this night. I can hear the Christmas bells ring as softly a church choir sings. It's the song used to praise the Ancient of Days when hope was born this night. There are angels in this place, and my heart resounds with the praise. Like a shepherd so scared, I'll rejoice and declare that hope was born this night. Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Let all of the world sing a chorus of joy, because hope was born this night. Gloria, 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 glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Let all of the world sing a chorus of joy, because hope was born this night. I said glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Let all of the world sing a chorus of joy, because hope was born this night. I know hope was born this night, because Christ was born this night, this night.
Welcome to Advent. If look around. How does the sanctuary look different from last week? No tree, no white pyramids. We are in green season. It is the Epiphany season, but the Sundays between now and the beginning of Lent are green. And so that's one cue, but we will still explore in Epiphany how God's light is spreading, the light that was born in Bethlehem, the light that radiates out through us to the world. I want to invite you to be mindful of the liturgy and today and the person who wrote it. Tom Kent is still being sedated. He is still intubated. And just think of that when you sing, yeah? And that leads me to a movement for today. I invite you to give Tom a virtual hug. Send him and his family a hug. And let's pray for them all, for Tom, for Carol, Leslie, and Aaron. And yeah. So let's, can we have, oh, there's a, okay. Let us begin this worship service in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I was waiting for that text on the screens, and it wasn't there. Yeah.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. You lead me by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. For your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Your love and justice, God of Jacob. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. For your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Yeah, your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Yeah, your grace is enough, heaven reaches out to us, your grace is enough for me. God, I sing your grace is enough. Yeah, I'm covered in your love. Your grace is enough for me. Enough for me.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Pray to the Lord,
have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. For peace in the world, for the health of God's church, and for all unity, let us pray to the Lord, have mercy.
Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy. For this holy house, and we who offer praise, let us pray to the Lord have mercy. Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us. Gracious Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Amen. This is the feast of victory. Feast of victory for our God. This is the feast of victory. Alleluia, alleluia. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, His blood to set us free. People of God, to serve the Lord. Serve the Lord forever. Power, riches, wisdom, strength, honor, blessing, glory, all belong to God on high. Alleluia, alleluia. This is the feast of victory, feast of victory for our God. This is the feast of victory. Alleluia, alleluia. Sing with all God's holy people. Join the hymn of all creation. Blessing, honor, glory, might be to God and the Lamb forever. Amen. Amen. This is the feast of victory. Feast of victory for our God. For the Lamb who once was slain has begun His reign forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Transforming God, in Christ Jesus you make all things new, turning the status quo on its head, and calling us to push out of our comfort zones for the sake of others. Strengthen our faith through your holy word and meet me, that we might carry Jesus' message with us to the world. In his name we pray.
Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, alleluia. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have those words of eternal.
You all will be helping Mike and I this morning. The congregation will read the parts in the bold print. Our gospel lesson for today is taken from the Holy Gospel according to Mark chapter 2.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home. So many gathered around that there was no longer room for them, not even in front of the door. And he was speaking the word to them. Then some people came, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. And when they could not bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And after they dug through it, they let the mat down on which the paralytic lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic,
"Son, Your sins are forgiven.
Now some of the scribes were sitting there, questioning in their hearts.
Why does this fellow speak in this way? It is blasphemy. How can forgive sins but God alone?
At once, Jesus perceived in his spirit that they were discussing these questions among themselves. And he said to them,
Why do you raise such questions in your hearts? Which is easier to say to a paralytic, Your sins are forgiven, or to say, Stand up and take your mat and walk? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins.
He said to the paralytic,
I say to you, stand up, take your mat, and go to your home.
And he stood up and immediately took the mat and went out before all of them, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, Jesus went out again beside the sea. The whole crowd gathered around him, and he taught them. As he was walking along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him,
Follow me.
And he got up and followed him. And as he sat at dinner in Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were also sitting with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. When the scribes of the Pharisees saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, they said to his disciples, When Jesus heard this, he said to them,
Those who are well have no need for a physician, but those who are sick I have come to call, not the righteous, but sinners.
Now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting, and people came and said to him,
Why did John
Jesus said to them,
The wedding guests cannot fast while the bridegroom is with them, can they? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast on that day. No one sews a piece of unshrunken cloth on an old cloak. Otherwise, the patch pulls away from it, the new from the old, and the worst tear is made. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is lost. And so are the skins. But one puts new wine into fresh wineskins.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O God.
In my first congregation in South San Francisco, a committee existed by the name of Mutual Ministry Committee. At least in theory, the purpose of mutual ministry committees is to further the ministry of the pastor to the congregation and the congregation's ministry to the pastor, so mutually. I was in my early 40s and certainly no spring chicken, but I was also the congregation's first ever female pastor. All of the congregation's previous pastors had been older men, near or past their retirement age. Somehow the committee members tried to make it their mission to tell me how to do things the proper way. At least what was proper in their mind. And to convey and discuss complaints from other congregants. What were those complaints, you might wonder? The one complaint that I most vividly recall, even 15 years later, was an ongoing concern on how I sit on my little pew, that I didn't cross my legs. Other issues discussed included hairstyles, nail biting, and the committee's push to lay off the new church secretary. At the same time, there were many important issues that the Mutual Ministry Committee did not discuss, issues for which I really could have used their support. For example, it took the congregation not one but two congregational meetings to call me to be their pastor. The first time the congregation voted, I received less than the required 2/3 of the votes, which is highly unusual, especially as the call committee and the church council both had unanimously and without reservations recommended me. Older, much older internal conflicts within the congregation led some members to openly oppose my call. At least one person had decorated her car that day with "Vote No" placards. Asked after the first disastrous meeting whether I would still want to proceed in the call process, I said yes. Sometimes good things can come out of conflict. The call committee and council then sponsored an offsite meeting to build support. Eventually, I got enough support among the congregation and led my first worship service on Easter Sunday 2005. Given the peculiar circumstances of my call vote, I so much wish the mutual ministry committee would have deliberated how we might strengthen the pastor and the congregation's mutual ministry to each other, or the congregation's lack of unity, outreach, or mission. Unfortunately, the committee never even tried to discuss any of those important issues, and in doing so, missed valuable opportunities for revitalization and renewal. Concerns such as, why does our pastor not cross her legs? Why does she wear her hair a certain way? Or why does she support the new office staff? Are a perfect example of a group of people missing the forest for the trees. Questions can be revealing. Sometimes questions reveal far more about the person who asks them than about the person who is being asked. Take, for example, the kind of questions that Jesus was asked in today's gospel lesson. The religious experts and the crowds of lay people are watching Jesus and questioning his every move and motive. But are they asking the right questions? First, Jesus is surrounded by a crowd so large and such need of his healing that a handful of men resort to lowering their paralyzed friends through the roof, to a hole that they had opened in the roof to bypass the line that blocked the door. Jesus is moved by their faith, by their hunger for his ministry, and proclaims God's forgiveness to the paralyzed man. A group of religious experts in the crowd wonders out loud whether Jesus had the right to speak that way, or whether his words would amount to blasphemy. A little later, when Jesus eats at the tax collector Levi's home, alongside other tax collectors, another group of religious experts asked why he would keep such inappropriate company. And finally, when the Pharisees and John's disciples enter a period of fasting and mourning, but Jesus and his disciples did not, members of the crowd pushed Jesus for an explanation. These three sets of questions about Jesus' behavior are not genuine questions. The people who ask these questions do not really want to learn from Jesus. Rather, their questions reveal their judgment over Jesus' allegedly inappropriate behavior. The religious experts and the crowd are challenging Jesus because they have assumptions about what a good rabbi should be doing and how he should be doing it. And Jesus is not playing by their rules. The questions in the story are not real questions at all, but warnings for Jesus that he should stop acting the way he does. Instead of breaking the rules, Jesus should stick to the tried and true norms of their faith. The questions of the religious experts and of the crowd are just another example of people who are missing the forest for the trees. In his responses and through his actions, Jesus tells the religious experts and the lay people in the crowd what he considers the important lessons that he wants them to learn. Instead of wondering whether his words of forgiveness amount to blasphemy, they should have asked him about God's love for people who are hurting, or about the healing impact that the message of God's forgiving love has on people's lives. Instead of wondering whether it is okay to mingle with allegedly unworthy people, they should have asked him about who God's love and mercy are for. Had they asked him, he would have told them that God's love and God's mercy are for everyone. Instead of wondering whether it is okay for Jesus to disregard customary times of fasting and mourning, they should have asked him about his reasons for not observing the customary fasting and mourning rituals. For as long as Jesus is still alive, his friends must rejoice and celebrate. Fasting and mourning can wait until after his death. Jesus does not dispute the importance of questions, but he wants us to ask the right kind of questions. Questions about forgiveness, healing, mercy, and love. He wants us to reflect on our mission, purpose in life, and our divine calling. What might be ways for us, or might be ways that we are missing the forest for the trees? What might be examples of us getting so hung up on non-essential aspects of our faith tradition that we forget to remember the crucially important aspects of the gospel? Any ideas? What do you think? Examples? How about altar candles lit in the wrong direction? The color of the paraments being out of season? Not standing for the gospel lesson or prayers? Asking whether undeserving people end up getting food from the food closet? Not being able to memorize Bible verses the way we used to do it, and so on and so forth. What might be ways of us missing the forest for the trees? Do you know how the Apostle Paul answered this question? In his own way, mind though. If I speak in the tongues of humans and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable. It keeps no records of wrong. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. According to Paul, the gospel of Jesus Christ is a message of love, God's love, and our own love in return. When he edited his gospel, Mark combined the passage about asking the right questions with an enigmatic parable about the relationship between old and new ways of doing things. No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old cloak. Otherwise, the patch pulls away from it, the new from the old, and a worse tear is made. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is lost, and so are the skins. But one puts new wine into fresh wineskins. What is Jesus saying here? And what do these words add to his previous words about asking the right kind of questions? The issue at stake in this dispute is the relationship between the old and the new, the past and the future, time-honored ways, and uncharted territory. One does not repair an old coat with brand new fabric, just as one does not put lively, bubbling young wine that is still actively fermenting and producing carbon dioxide gas into older leather bags that might burst at the seams from all that excess gas. It is important to notice that Jesus does not make a value judgment about old versus new. Jesus does not suggest that old things are bad and new things are good, and that the bad old things ought to be scrapped in favor of the shiny new things. Instead, he seems to say that we must use the old things where it suits best and the new things where they are called for. Just as Jesus implied before that it is good to ask questions if we ask the right kind of questions, Jesus now seems to suggest that we use methods that are the right methods for a particular context. Our God is a God who doesn't want us to miss the forest for the trees. Our God is a God who calls us to respond to the spiritual hunger of the world in ways that are most appropriate. Sometimes the needs of the world might call for tried and true responses, like a piece of pre-shrunk fabric. At other times and places, the hunger of the world might call for new responses, like new wineskins. Let us open our hearts and minds to God, trusting that God will help us to reframe and reprioritize what truly matters, and that God's Holy Spirit will guide us to respond to the needs of the world in the best possible, most appropriate, and most merciful ways. Amen.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me. Because you died and arose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me. Because you died and arose again. Amazing love, how can it be now that you, my King, should die for me? Amazing love, and I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do, to honor you, in all I do,
to honor you. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be now? You, my King, should die for me. Amazing love,
amazing love.
Oh, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you. Amazing love,
amazing love.
Oh, how can it be now that you, my King, should die for me? Amazing love,
amazing love.
Oh, and I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you.
Let us join our hearts, our voices, our minds, and confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was dead. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Trusting in the good of Jesus Christ, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. You embrace the outcasts and the marginalized. Help us to reach across boundaries in our own communities so that all might flourish together. God, our teacher and healer, in mercy, hear our prayer. As a fully embodied human being, you ate and drank the produce of the land. Guide farmers and all food producers to tend and keep the earth so that they might feed people and communities in sustainable ways. God, our teacher and healer, in our prayer. Your strengthen leaders to God our so many are in need of loving God mind or spirit from within our own experience lift up those who need Tom Kent Eric Gellman Russell Terry Kettner, Jan Dutton, Patty Rathbun, Linda Roche, Rod Sorensen, Dee Dee Thompson, Audrey Worth, and all whose names we now mention in the silence of our hearts. God, our teacher and healer, we can't sew the new and shrunken cloth of your truth and justice onto the old cloak of the systems that perpetuate injustice. Make us brave to cut away what divides us and creates new systems out of new cloth, woven with your all-embracing love. God, our teacher and healer, we thank you for all the saints who have led us to Jesus' table throughout your lives. Inspire us by their examples to invite others into Jesus' love. God, our teacher and healer. Confident that in Christ Jesus you answer prayers, we lift to all of those, all for whom we pray, aloud in our hearts through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
And we will gather the offering gifts at the communion table when you come up.
Let's share a sign of Christ's peace.
Yes.
Do they have a song? Yeah, they do.
Let the vineyards be fruitful, O Lord, fill to the brim our cup of blessing. Gather a harvest from the seeds that were sown, that we may be fed with the bread of love. Gather the hopes and dreams of all, unite them with the prayers we
God, who works justice for the oppressed, we offer our gifts from what you have first given us to carry out this work in your name, in and through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should in all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection open to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy, mighty, and merciful God, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and the suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming again in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. And let us continue this meal praying together in the words that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come, for all is now ready. Christ welcomes you in body, mind, spirit, to bring healing to you through this meal, and healing to the world through you. You are invited to come and feast on him so that you yourself become the bread of life, broken and given for the sake of the life of the world. And so that each and everyone safely can receive the light-colored cups in the center of the tray contain grape juice, and gluten-free wafers are available upon request. We will start on this side, guided by the ushers, and gradually move over this side. So come as you are. Christ invites you to feast with and on him.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us, Lamb of God. You take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us, Lamb of God. You take away the sin of the world.
This is also a song written by Tom Kent.
Who are the three
who came from afar. Three wise men who followed a star. What did they see? What did they know? What did they find in that manger low? The babe in Bethlehem, who was he? Who brought them all on bended knee? They brought him gifts so precious and rare to worship this king, a child so fair. Gold for a boy was a kingly gift, frankincense for spirits to lift. Myrrh was a sign of things to come, all for a child, the chosen one. How could they know, how could they seek an infant boy so mild and meek? He was the one anointed of God to carry a staff, the shepherd's rod. Gold for a boy was a kingly gift, frankincense for spirits to live, myrrh a sign of things to come, all for a child, the chosen one. Gold for a boy was a kingly gift, frankincense for spirits to live, myrrh a sign of things to come, all for a child, the chosen one. Guess who wrote this one?
Sleeper, awake, arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Look to the Lord wherever you are, and He will see you through. Jesus, He calls to hearts young and old. His love will shine on you. Lift up your eyes and look to His light. Your heart will be made strong and true. Season of light, season of word, Epiphany calls to us all. To Christ we now belong, as we lift our hearts in song. Forever we will follow Him along. Sleeper, arise, turn on the light, move on ahead with all your might. Because in Christ we are made new, in Him we are reborn, with Him we'll forever belong.
I'll take a little song here.
his death we are baptized, in his new life born again. We're called from the darkness to the light.
Yes, we are.
Well, together we stand. Yes, together we will praise. We will sing. Yeah, we'll sing the great amen.
Help us out now.
Season of light, it's a season of word. You know epiphany calls to us all. To Christ we will belong as we lift our hearts in song. Forever we'll follow him along. It's a season of light, it's a season of the word, 'cause epiphany calls to us all. Yeah, to Christ we will belong as we lift our hearts in song. Forever we will follow him along.
Get well, Tom.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray together. God, in this meal, you have shared yourself and your radical love with us. May your presence flood us with hope. Each day bring us fresh insights and fill us with grateful joy. Guide by your Spirit, may we see the world around us with your eyes, filled with potential and brimming with promise. Amen.
And may the Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you and keep you forever. May God's light shine into your hearts and into your minds, and through you, may you touch the world. May he touch the world through you with his love, his forgiveness, and his grace. Amen. So a few announcements before we get to the slides. We have two people among us that will be here, won't be here next Sunday. In one case, only next few Sundays. That is Keith Montag, who will have surgery coming up, second knee surgery, and doesn't want to be exposed to our germs before the surgery. And then much longer. Ed is moving to Florida. And this was Ed's last Sunday with us. We miss your calmness, your calm energy, your joyful playing. And let's pray together. Lord, we ask for your blessings on Ed and Carol and their whole family. Strengthen them through each other's companionship. Bless Annika, too, with their presence, and help them find a community in Florida where they and their gifts can thrive. We give you thanks for the many years of joyful, humble service that this family has brought to us, for all the inspiration, all their patience, all their love. God, watch over them, protect them, and grant them your health, your wholeness, your peace.
Amen.
Amen. So let's go through slides. One is that we will have a class in the fellowship hall today. Finally, the day is here. This is a project of our wellness committee, and it is long overdue. So we have, I think, 20 people signed up. And if you are one of them, please head over to the fellowship hall. There will be eventually pizza, and before the class, we'll eat beforehand. And it's a really good thing that we learn to take care of each other should there be crises here or elsewhere where we can apply the skills that we'll learn in this class. So then, and thank you to all, to Pat, who has served as the registrar, to Ernie and Debbie Liberini. All three of them are setting up there. Helping the Kathy Morrow, the teacher, set up. So anyway, then next slide. Martin Luther King Jr. Day, there is nobody in the office tomorrow, so office is closed. Then next one. And on January 18th, we have the opportunity to serve at the food closet. We shortened the hours a little bit to make this easier on people's bodies and kind of define better what we are doing and what we are not doing. If we are doing this from 9 to 11, then nobody will have to be at the rows of cars or so, and that's the heavier part of the work. And you can be sitting down, you can be standing while you work there, but anyway, that's that purple creature is not Spider-Man, that's supposed to be you. So a reminder that there are still empty spots, I believe, on the, yeah. Barbara, do you want to speak to that? Okay. How about I'll hand you this.
Okay. Thank you. The big need we have, as always, is the evening. All the other slots are filled, but we have Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday with no one signed up at all. So if you know someone who'd be willing to help us out, they don't have to be members of the church. They're just willing to come and spend some time in the evening. Being there to make sure everything goes well, please have them contact us, or if you have decided that you finally can do it now, we'd really appreciate it. So any help.
Is it still true that we need especially guys?
Yes, we do, especially need men. We have more women volunteering than men. But we do have the Friends Church, and they're doing all of Wednesday. So that's really a help for us, including the evening.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. And just a quick reminder, our outreach also includes this month, as usually, the work of some of our members at St. John's Program for Real Change. So thank you to all who will be there for representing our congregation. Actually, that's good. Then, over the next few months, we will have sort of a monthly workshop that deals with end-of-life issues. We'll start with a pastor who talks, who will guide us to consider how way down the road. We want the last bit of our lives, what we want that last bit of our lives to be like, and how it might inform how we live today and over the next few decades. Yeah. So that's Susan Scott. Then the month after, Robin will do something specifically on healthcare, kind of, and the legalities around that. Then and then month three, yet to be determined, depending on how things went the first 2 months, what is needed most. So, and we have a fantastic big TV in our fellowship hall, bigger than that TV, I think. And on February 11th, we have the opportunity to enjoy a combined game day and Super Bowl day. So from 2 to maybe 3:30 games. And for various ages, bring your favorite board games, card games, dice games, whatever. And then when Super Bowl starts, we can reconfigure this to our needs, bring in maybe the sofa or so and armchairs from the small meeting room or so, and watch Super Bowl game. So that's, I think, a great way to enjoy this together. So. And their sports fans don't have to be home alone with no family members being interested in sports. So then from February on, we will on the fourth Friday of the month have 1 hour of tech training. Each month will be a different topic. We will announce what it will be, what it will be in February. It's most likely starts with cell phones or maybe just one topic, one app, how to do this. 20 minutes of kind of teaching and then practicing in little teams. So that's kind of communication skills in this world are important. And we can learn this together in a really patient atmosphere and setting where all questions are allowed and where we go at a pace that is appropriate for those who are there. So that's that. And was that the last slide? Okay, announcements are done for at least, okay. Pardon?
Flower chart.
Yay, forgot it. That was on my worship outline and that's back there. There is a new flower chart out in the narthex. Please, it's wide open as it's new, and feel free to add your name there. And remember, it doesn't have to be an expensive bouquet. Just bring something. Bring a potted plant from home and take it back home. Or bring an artificial flower arrangement or something. Yeah, just add your beautiful touch to our altar and to the communion meal. So, and yes. Yeah. Whoop.
Hey, you even have your mic with you.
Yeah.
Cool.
I don't know if I need.
shall I send thee? How shall I send thee? Well, I'm going to send thee one by one, one for the little baby. Baby was born, born, born in Bethlehem. Children, go where I send thee. How
4 by 4.
I'm going to send thee 4 by 4. 4 for the 4 that stood at the door. 3 for the Hebrew children. 2 for Paul and Silas. 1 for the little bitty. Baby was born, born, born in Bethlehem. Children, go where I send thee. How
7 by 7.
I'm going to send thee 7 by 7. 7 for the 7 that never got to heaven. 6 for the 6 that couldn't get a fix. 5 for the gospel preachers. 4 for the 4 that stood at the door. 3 for the Hebrew children. 2 for Paul and Silas. 1 for the little bitty. Baby was born, born, born in Bethlehem. Children, go where I send thee. How
10 by 10.
I'm going to send thee 10 by 10. 10 for the 10 commandments. 9 for the 9 all dressed so fine. 8 for the 8 that stood at the gate. 7 for the 7 that never got to heaven. 6 for the 6 that couldn't get it fixed. 5 for the gospel preachers. 4 for the 4 that stood at the door. 3 for the Hebrew children. 2 for Paul and Silas. 1 for the little bitty. Baby was born, born, born in Bethlehem. Who was born, born, born in Bethlehem.
One more.
He was born, 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 born in Bethlehem.
I'm casting my cares aside. I'm leaving my past behind. I'm setting my heart and mind on you, Jesus. Reaching my hand to yours, believing there's so much more. Knowing that all you have in store for me is good. Is good. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day. Oh, oh, oh. I'm putting my feet.